Welcome back. I'm sure you've enjoyed that time of music and prayer and confession. So we're continuing on the series Relationship Heart Questions, and I tell you, questions are vital to living. The two major chapters we have in the Bible concerning marriage is Matthew chapter 19 and 1 Corinthians chapter 7. But thank God somebody asked the questions, because in Matthew chapter 19 verse 3, it was the Pharisees that asked Jesus, can we divorce our wife for any and every reason? Then he took his time to teach and to explain about marriage. Then in 1 Corinthians 7, 1, he was Paul. I said, you wrote me a letter asking me a question about marriage. This is my answer. So I'm happy that somebody asked. That is why I never joke with questions in our own church. You know, whenever I'm around on a Tuesday, I'll try as much as possible to make sure that we have a question and answer session, because many a times wisdom is in the heart of he that has it. It takes a man of understanding to draw it out. That is good, to draw it out, because when you draw it out, you don't draw it out only for yourself, you draw it out for eternity. Can you imagine the Pharisees? Thank God they asked Jesus that question, because he blesses me and he's blessed you. And thank God for the Corinthians that wrote that letter to Paul and asked him about marriage, because the things Paul said had blessed generations and congregations across several nations. So that's why it's very important for you to take time to ask the hard questions. Last week, we had three very hard questions that we treated. One of them is the lady that said, I met a man that is handsome and not walking, but he has a temper. He said, we should be fine if I don't make him angry. But it's quick to ask for my forgiveness, even after he has lost his temper and he eats me. Will you advise that we go ahead and marry? I answered that last week. You need to go listen to my answer. It's going to bless you tremendously. And if you know anybody around you that's in a relationship like that, where one of them has a short fuse, has a high temper, make sure they watch and that one I did last Sunday. Another question is, last week was, I met this guy, I'm married. Is it possible for me to divorce and remarry? And what are the biblical conditions? And we took time to explain that. We took a lot of time to explain it in five planes, the way Paul and Jesus explain it. If you, all that. So you need to go watch that and listen to that. It's going to bless you. Then I think last week we took one more. See, I met the girl of my dreams. Oh, but I just came out of an heartbreaking relationship. Can I go ahead and propose to her? And I try to give my answer to getting involved with somebody that has an heartbreak and what to do and how to handle that. So today, I have so many questions and we have to round up today. Next Sunday is Father's Day. I'm doing the Father's Day message, and after that, I'm moving on to another very, very important message. So today, I'm starting with the couples. There's a question here. Wow. must my wife or husband be my next of kin at work? Must my wife or husband be my next of kin at work? Actually, a lady put something on Twitter. She said she works in HR in her company, and she discovered that almost every man puts their wife as their next of kin, but 80% of the Nigerian women either put their young child or their sister or their brother or their parent as their next of kin. And she wondered why. I wonder why too. Because the best thing is for your spouse to be your next of kin. Next of kin, the way we think about next of kin, is only about the financial benefit if there is a tragedy. But beyond that, next of kin is the point of first contact when there is an issue. If you faint at work, if you have a problem at work, on the record, who can we call first? And I think that should be your spouse. But what this shows me is that there is already a trust issue. Number one, why marry somebody that you can't trust to start with? If you can't trust them enough as your next of kin, then I believe they're not worthy to be your spouse for life. I believe so very strongly. Let me explain it to you this way. Trust is the backbone backbone of every relationship, trust. Once you take trust out of a relationship, what remains is a carcass. The main thing has departed. So for you not to put your spouse as a nest of kin, it's a proof that there are trust issues already. I told somebody, I said, no matter how terrible your wife is, there is nobody that can take care of your children if you, after your demise, like your wife. No matter how terrible you think your husband is, most of the time, nobody can take care of the kids more than him. So why other people? In our continent, Africa, we've seen a lot of times in which one of the spouses depart and the family comes in immediately. I officiated a funeral in the north and I was surprised, marooned, flabbergasted, overwhelmed. I couldn't believe my eyes. We finished the burial. The next day, the father of the dead guy was in the house picking television and wanted to pick, panting, packing the undies of his son. He said, belongs to my son. I found that very amusing. What kind of people are these? But it happens. So I'm trying to say, and I'm trying to advise, that I would have preferred it being your spouse. But if your spouse is not your next of kin, it's a proof that it's a trust issue already that should be addressed. And I think that what we should address, not the issue of next of kin, because beyond that, there is a fear, there is a trust issue that we need to sort and settle. The problem with trust, unlike forgiveness, is that forgiveness can come in an instant, but with trust, it will take time and truth. So if you are the kind of a spouse that you yourself know that you are not trustworthy to be a next of kin, I want you to please gradually now build trust again in your marriage, because trust is the backbone, is the foundation for every relationship. You got that? Okay, so this from a lady. I met a guy that said I must marry him or we miss God's will for me forever. Like that guy. So if you don't marry me, you will miss God's will for your life forever. I am the will of God for you. Wow. Yes, I've had that before. In our days, it was even very funny. Somebody will carry a big Bible, go to a lady and say, excuse me, God told me to marry you. I told the ladies, I said, please ask the guy, so what are you saying? You've told me what God said, you've not told me what you are saying. You said, God said, I should marry you, I should marry you, yeah. But you, what are you saying? Well, I believe very strongly God communicates with people. I believe very strongly God leads us into who we should marry. I also believe very strongly that the teaching that is erroneous is that from heaven God had paired us together. I think that is erroneous. So I said, Reverend, you are a man of God. Yes, that's why I don't believe it. The way they made us feel is that when God had made us, he took one of my bones and formed a woman. And that when I get on earth, if I don't meet that woman, I'm in trouble. Because God had used my bones. When my mom used to pray, she asked for boys. You will not carry another person's bone. I don't know if your mom prayed that kind of a prayer. In fact, I'm wondering if mothers have a school of mothering where they teach them how to do the same thing. Because when we talk, we just discover all of a sudden all mothers behave the same. It's very interesting. So, okay, I don't believe that from heaven God had paired us together like that. Somebody said, I found it amazing that a pastor does not believe that. I don't believe it as a biblical foundation. If you know me, the problem I have had always been, anything that does not have a biblical foundation, I don't believe it. And if I don't believe it, I'm not going to teach it. So I'm going to prove to you with three very important points why I don't believe that from heaven God had paired us together. And when I'm done, I will now teach you what I believe heaven does. What I believe is the mind and the plan of God to make you marry right, because you can marry right. Very important. And God needs to be involved in who you marry. If you don't make God the Genesis, don't expect him to come in at the Revelation. If God is not the foundation, don't expect him to be the roof. So it's very important for you to know. My belief is that number one, God had not paired us up from heaven. Number two, God needs to be involved in who you marry, because God knows more than you about that person. And number three, that is a part you have to play. So let me start from three reasons why I don't believe that God had paired us together from heaven. heaven. I don't believe that God appeared us together from heaven. Number one. Number one reason why I don't believe God appeared us together from heaven is the fact that God does not override the will of man. God. The greatest gift God gave man is his will. You have a will, I have my will. If God controls our will, Adam will not have fallen. If God controls our will, a lot of things won't happen in this world. Even you yourself, God leads you sometimes and you don't obey. So if God controls our will, we won't be in this mess we are in. But God does not. Why did God not? Because he didn't want to make a machine. The difference between a machine and a human being is the free will. So God made us a free moral agent. The meaning of that is that we can either say yes to his will or no to his will. Yeah, we can. So the Bible says, for example, in 1 Timothy 2:4, that God desires that all men should be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. That is God's desire, that all men, you, myself, anybody, get saved and come. That is God's will. That's God's desire. But you know what? His will has not happened because some men choose not to be saved. Some men choose not to come to the knowledge of the truth. So, and because they choose not to, there is nothing God does about it. It is their will. It is their choice. So I'm trying to say, assuming God from heaven had written that me, Albert, should marry Sister Zerubbabel. But for some reason, I refuse because I have my free will to marry Sister Zerubbabel. That means there is already two problems. The pastor Sister Zerubbabel needs to marry two. I married somebody else. So the somebody else I've married, that is a problem because that one should have been married to somebody else. Do you get that? Then Sister Zerubbabel too went to marry somebody who should have been married to somebody else. Then that one too, we have to marry somebody. Before we were born, he would have scattered. Think about it. Think. You see, the Bible talks about the renewing of our mind, not the removing of our mind. When we become Christian, we are not meant to remove our mind. We are meant to renew it. So, man is a free moral agent. If God told me to marry TJ and I decide not to marry TJ, that means that there will be a problem because TJ will have to marry somebody else's husband, have married somebody else's wife, and then that husband that was meant to be the husband of the person I married, we now have to go and marry somebody else, and then that thing we have scattered long before now. I mean, what are you talking about? Long before we were born, they would have scattered everything by the free will, and God does not prevail over our free will. That's number one. Number two, the Bible said in a few places, 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 4, he said, let a young widow under the age of 60 go and remarry. let me just say to you that if indeed God had given us from heaven, that means a widow should not remarry. Think about it. Because if a widow and a widower remarry, they must marry somebody else's born. Except if God had created spare wife and spare husband. And that does not look like God to me. Human beings are not tired. You can't have spare tire, have spare husband, and have spare wife. I don't believe that is the way of God. Let me give you an example. 1 Corinthians 7:39, the Passion Translation. It says, a wife is bound in marriage covenant as long as her husband is living. But if the husband dies, she is free to marry again as she desires. She's free to marry again as he desires. So if God had joined us one by one from heaven, does that mean that God wants some people to die? Does that mean God had made some people spare wives and spare husbands? I don't believe so. That is number two reason why I don't believe God had joined us from heaven. Number three is because the Bible actually said in 1 Corinthians chapter number 7 verse 15, this is very interesting, that if people divorce, they have a right to remarry. 7:15. He said, if the husband or wife is not a believer, decides to leave, let them leave. When this happens, the brother or sister in Christ is free. He's free to remarry. He's free to remarry. Message translation put it this way. He said, if the unbelieving spouse walks out, You have no to let him or her go. You don't have to hold on desperately. God has called us at the very best to live peaceably as we can. So which means that if somebody leaves you, you are free to remarry. And that means that God, did God plan the divorce? No, he couldn't have. So somebody had to disobey, then God hates divorce. But divorce, the Bible said the other party can go ahead and remarry. So if God has joined us like that from heaven, one to one, then that other person goes to remarry. That means that other person is marrying somebody else's bone. It's not so. So with these 3 points of mine, I hope I'll be able to convince you that did not happen. So what happened? Matthew 15, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Once you make God your Lord, once I said there are 3 things that are most important decisions you have to make in life. If you didn't listen to that message, go to my YouTube page now. Subscribe to the channel Alberto Duole. The message they are making, destiny decision, will change your life. It's the best thing that can happen to you this week. Listening to that message, making destiny decision, Alberto Duole YouTube channel. Just go to YouTube, type Alberto Duole. We take you to my channel. Subscribe to my channel. Watch making destiny decision. It will save you from destiny wreck. I said there are 3 major decisions we need to make. Who is going to be your Lord? That's about who is going to be your Lord. Number 2, who is going to be your leader? That's the issue of mentor. The issue of who is going to be your Lord is the issue of master. Who is going to be your leader? Leader is the issue of mentor. Who is going to be your lover? The issue of marriage. Those 3 things are very important. So it is LLL that leads to MMM. LLL, leader, Lord, leader, lover. MMM, which is master, mentor, marriage. Amen. When you give your life to Christ, God becomes very passionate about you. And God knows that there is somebody that if the two of you come together, you will get the best of life. You'll be able, Bible says, for this scripture, the man of Israel and the cleave to Israel and two of them will become one flesh. God knows the one that we combine with your one to make a complete one can make things work. And that is why you need to go with God in leading you aright to marry right. You need the help of God. So you cannot choose right without God, and it's better for you to walk with God in your choice. Am I talking to somebody? So when God is your Lord, then make sure that he leads you to your lover. When God is your master, make sure he leads you in your marriage. Because when you do that, you have a lot of peace. I tell people, many a times, don't marry somebody that when there is trouble, you have to be saying, but God, I'm sorry, I'm not sure you even told me to marry him. Marry somebody that in the midst of trouble, you'll be able to say, but God, I thought you told me to go ahead. Did you get that? Beautiful. Let me take a few more questions. There's a question here. Reverend, I found the person I want to marry, but my parents disagree. Should I go ahead? Should I stop? What should I do? Good question. Oh, I love these hard questions. Good questions. It's good to obey your parents. There are 10 commandments in the Old Testament. 10. Only one of them has a reward attached to it. The other 9, just do them. God said, do them, you do them. But this one, God said, if you do them, I will make sure you live long. I will make sure it is well with you and that. Wow! Mike Murdock says, I don't pray for long life. He said, I just honor my father and my mother. Because God had told us that is the key to long life. Honor your father and your mother, Ephesians 6:2. Honor your father and your mother, which is the first commandment with the promise that you will be well with thee and you will live long upon the earth. Beautiful. Honor them. But I love the way one translation put it. He said, honor your father and mother in the Lord. So my question is, why did your parents say you should not go ahead? You know, I was hoping that the first person I will have a relationship with is the one I'll marry. It didn't happen like that. I had a lady that we were close, we started the relationship. It didn't work out. Yeah, she was in her final year when I was in my second year. Don't look at me like that. She was just 2 years older than I am. Why you say ha ha? You too. Why you say ha ha? But it didn't work out. But I went to her and I told her, look, I just came to say to you, no matter what, you say you're not doing it, and I agree with you, but I want us to part on a good note. So that in the future, if my son sees your daughter, or your son sees my daughter, we won't allow whatever happened between us to make us say we cannot allow this relationship to go on. That's one of the major problems we have in the world today. A man and a woman that had a problem from the university days that are causing problems for their children right now getting married. No. The question is the case, why are your parents disagreeing? I explained it in one of my posts that when your parent says no, don't fight them over it, because after a while, the reason won't be important. What they'll be shouting is, I sent you to school, I took care of you, I didn't disobey my parents, you are disobeying me. So when they say no, appeal. When they say no, keep quiet. Find a way around it, start to pray, get somebody that can talk to them. Do all you can do to get them to agree. But for me, the basic reason is, why are they saying no? You see, there's a proverb in Africa that what a young man will see climbing a tree, the elderly man underneath the tree will be able to see it better. If a young man is one cutting the tree, the elderly man will know where the tree will fall. It's the power of experience. So when your parents are saying no, find out why. I've had a situation before that somebody came to me and said, I want to marry that girl, but the dad is saying no. I went to the dad, and what the dad said to me was so revealing. The dad said, don't mind the boy is stingy. I said, how can you say that? The man said they've been dating for 2 years, ordinary loaf of bread, the boy never brought to this house. I asked my daughter, has he ever given you an handkerchief before? My daughter said no. I said, sir, you are right. The boy is really stingy. He's really an Because me that lay hands on him, lay legs on him as a pastor, gave him money for handout, gave him money for transport. Now that he's graduated and has a job in the bank, ordinary one penny he had never given me. It's really stingy. But then I thought about it. So an elderly man, even me, the pastor, could not see that. But an elderly man could. I'm trying to say to you, be very, very careful. When your parents are saying no, find out why. You see, when we were the way Africa used to be, before you even marry somebody, the parents would send an emissary to their town to find out what are they like in that town. Emissary to the family, what are they like in that family? Do you know now, even the medical world has caught up with them. The medical world is now saying that most of the things, including mental illness, including diabetes and cancer, is in the family. So our parents knew what they were doing. They were not stupid as you people think. So if your parents said no, please find out why. If the reason now is not a good reason, if the reason is, for example, I don't want you to marry an Igbo man, or I don't want you to marry from that family, and there is no tangible reason, I want you to marry my friend's daughter, son. If those are the reasons, number one, like I said, pray. Number two, find somebody that can talk to them. Number three, wait as long as you could. After a while, when your friends are getting married, their friends will be asking them, when is your daughter's own? You'll be telling the friends, I'm ready, my parents are not ready. Okay? But after you have tried all that and there is no headway, then I can now say one more thing. If you don't get your parental blessing, make sure you get pastoral blessing. And if you have a good pastor like me, if your parents say no, I will go and talk to them. I'll go and beg them. I'll go and appeal to them. If they still say no, and I believe you're on the right track, I will now bless you and join you. But those are extreme cases. Before we get there at all, we will have done everything humanly possible to persuade your parents to give their consent. It's just I don't believe that we should hold you perpetually in bondage for reasons that are not reasonable. The Bible says, in Ephesians chapter 6 verse 2, honor your father and your mother, which first commanded with the promise. Verse 3 said, that it may be well with you, and you will live long upon the earth. Then verse 4 said, but you fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath, but bring them in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. Many a times people don't even know verse 3 exists, because most of people that preach are fathers. And they don't want you to know that he also said, we fathers should not provoke our children to wrath. We shouldn't. So if there is no biblical reason for us to say no, please don't let us say no. I think the singles are winning. There are more questions from the singles than the married. This one is a good question, the seventh question. I met this cool, nice, handsome guy, but he's an unbeliever. Can I go ahead and marry him? Hey, I'm going to appeal to you to marry a non-believer. Somebody say why? Number one, the Bible says so clearly. 2 Corinthians 6:14 to 16, the Message translation. It said, don't become partners with those who reject God. How can you make a partnership, a relationship, a marriage out with right and wrong? Right? What's that? That's not partnership. That's war. That's war. It's like best friends with darkness. Does Christ go strolling with the devil? Do trust and mistrust hold hands? Who will think of setting up a pagan idol in holy temple? But that is exactly what you are trying to do. Each of us is a temple in whom God lives. God himself put it this way, and live in them, and move into them. I'll be their God, and they'll be my people. But look at verse 17. It says, so leave the corruption, the compromise, leave it for God, says God. Don't link up with those who will pollute you. I want you all to myself. I'll be a father to you and to your sons and daughters. I love the way KJV put it. He said, don't be equally yoked with an unbeliever. What is a yoke? A yoke is when you put two animals together to work on a farm. So a yoke is for purpose and productivity. But there are unequal yokes. When you put two animals that are not equal together, instead of them to be productive, it becomes counterproductive. When you marry an unbeliever, it's an unequal yoke. It becomes counterproductive. You don't get the desire you want. Number one, between my wife and I, for example, no matter the issue we have, the Bible is a final authority. An unbeliever, the Bible is not a final authority. He says, I want to have a girlfriend. You say no, or based on what authority will you agree? Another thing is the fact that, I had a case in which a lady called me and said, my husband wants to just had a baby. My husband wants to scrape the head of the baby and all that. I said, scrape the head of the baby. Why? I said, well, he's a Muslim. I said, I'm sorry, that's their tradition. That is what they believe. So I'm trying to say to you that we need to be careful when it comes to marrying. And you see, when you marry an unbeliever, the devil becomes your father-in-law. Yes, the devil becomes your father-in-law. And you know the father-in-law must visit. And when they visit, they come with gifts. So when the devil visits you, we come with headache and backache and hypertension and low hypertension. And there is nothing you can do about that. So I'm trying to say to you, make sure you don't do it. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 7:39, this is very key. 1 Corinthians 7:39, Paul was speaking to widows. And widows could be under a lot of prayer. But he said to widows in 1 Corinthians 7:39, the Living Bible translation says, the wife is part of her husband as long as he lives. But if the husband dies, then she may marry again, but only if she marries a Christian. So even a widow that is under prayer, that might not have enough opportunity to make a choice, Paul is still saying, make sure you marry a Christian. Number eight. I think I'll just take this and stop. There's so many questions, but maybe in the future we'll take some of them. Can I marry someone due to the word of some prophets or based on dreams? Joseph and Josephine. Don't marry somebody based on dream and visions alone. Ecclesiastes 5:7, even your own dream, say your dream come to a multitude of business. If you think of Angelina, you watch Angelina, you are looking at Angelina picture, when you sleep, you will sleep Angelina, you will see Angelina in your dreams. So your dreams does not particularly mean God is leading you in that direction, especially when God has not been leading you in other means in your dreams before. Isaiah 29 verse 8, the prophet said, this is the prophet speaking, he said, when you are hungry and you sleep, you will see food in your dream. Yes, when you are hungry. You will see food in your dream. He said, but notwithstanding, when you wake up, you will still be hungry. Don't let that be the predominant factor in who you will marry. In 1 Corinthians 13:8, Paul was emphatic about it. He said, dreams, visions, prophecies can fail, but it's only love that never fails. See, I've always believed in the principle that the source of a thing is the sustenance of it. So if the source of your marriage is love, the sustenance will be love. But if the source of your marriage is somebody's prophecy, you will need that prophecy to also sustain it too. So when your wife says, I'm leaving, you say, yeah, I perceive, thus share the Lord, you shall not leave, or something. Because the source of a thing must be the sustainer. Don't let the prophet be one to tell you who to marry. Because if you let the prophet tell you who to marry, then Bible says he that findeth a wife, Proverbs 18:22, not he that the prophet findeth a wife for. And all this witchcraft of bring three names. Any prophet, any parent that expects you to have three names is wicked. That means we have one male catch and two side chicks. Or two side guys, go and bring three names. Where is that done? That means you didn't even trust me enough to have narrowed down to one person. You expect me to have three people? No, that itself is not right. Will you be happy if your children are kept as number two and number three on the list? It shouldn't be so. So please don't marry because of the word of a prophet. All the prophet in the New Testament can do is not to give you direction, but to give you confirmation. If God had told you to go ahead, then they can confirm, but they don't give direction. Oh my God, so many questions still, but the time has gone. We need to stop now. I'm sure you've been tremendously blessed. I've been tremendously blessed in this series myself. All the editions is on my YouTube page. Alberto Duale, subscribe. You can get all the editions and watch them as you want from the beginning to the end. Don't go yet. I'll be back with you after this time out. Wait for me.